"I'm always amazed," wrote George Orwell in 1945, "when I hear people saying that sport creates goodwill between the nations, and that if only the common peoples of the world could meet one another at football or cricket, they would have no inclination to meet on the battlefield." At the international level, Orwell writes, "sport is frankly mimic warfare. But the significant thing is not the behavior of the players, but the attitude of the spectators, and behind the spectators of the nations who work themselves into furies over these absurd contests, and seriously believe, at any rate for short periods, that running, jumping, and kicking a ball are tests of national virtue." So the Summer Olympics have been in progress for a couple of weeks now, and Orwell's essay, The Sporting Spirit, captures a contradiction that has struck me over and over again the past few months while Rio prepared for the games and since they started. Brazil is going through some really rough economic times right now, and Rio's winning bid as an Olympic host city made a lot of people really upset. At least a quarter of Rio's population lives in impoverished neighborhoods, many of them in the favelas or shanty towns that the opening ceremonies aggrandized. Some 60,000 of those people are said to have been displaced from their homes to make way for the necessarily expansive and expensive Olympic complex. Amid a tanking economy, political resentment, rampant police killings, and a crumbling infrastructure, the arrival of the Olympics to Rio de Janeiro has sparked protests and a lot of criticism. But it's the Olympics. The Olympic Games are supposed to be different, right? I mean, the second fundamental principle in the Olympic Charter even reads, "The goal of Olympism is to place sport at the service of the harmonious development of humankind, with a view to promoting a peaceful society concerned with the preservation of human dignity." When NPR reporter Lulu Garcia Navarro asked Francisco Aragão, a Santa Marta food kiosk owner, if he was enjoying watching the show on TV, he said, "No." "Who's enjoying these games?" he said. "Not the poor. It's only for the tourists. Brazil doesn't have the money for these games. Our hospitals are a mess. The government has put up a facade to hide the truth." So clearly there's a contradiction here. But among the economic and political conflicts surrounding the Rio Olympics, I think one key here is to recognize that for most of us, even a lot of the people in the favelas surrounding the games themselves, the Olympics are a fundamentally mediated spectacle. And as such, the games exist as a series of signs. So it's probably not at all earth-shattering to consider how the Olympic Games are saturated with and constituted through multiple layers of signs and sign systems. But take a second to consider the Olympics as an embodied physical literal presence. The Olympics don't occur at one permanent site like they did in antiquity at the sanctuary of Zeus in Greece. Rather, the modern Olympic Games require a new, gargantuan investment every 4 years by which the host city must construct a new, spectacular stadium and village to house the Games and their participants. But in a way, none of these structures is distinct from the others. Rather, the Olympic structure is itself a sign, any particularities of its architecture becoming subsumed under an enforced signification, modernity, humanism, festive capitalism, and by extension, the host nation's glorious participation in these concepts. In sum, the Olympic structure signifies a sort of competitive Pax Humana. But as we've seen, this meaning is contradicted both by the lived reality of the games themselves and, in cases like Rio, by the local population. The ideology behind the Olympic Games is interested in suturing up the rifts between signification, what the Olympics are supposed to mean, and reality, which is always threatening to mess with the Olympic signifier. What happens next seems to me to take the form of what Terry Eagleton in his book Ideology and Introduction summarizes as semiotic closure. The idea behind this is basically that signs are infinitely productive, meaning that there's an element of play and perpetual motion involved in how we construct meaning. The Olympic structure, the signifiers of Olympicness, are always under threat of meaning something other than humanism or celebration or competitive peacemaking. Garcia Navarro and others have reported on how Rio has cracked down on protesters, even people wearing shirts with dissenting political slogans on them. David Siegel of the New York Times reported that there are 85,000 heavily armed soldiers stationed in the city right now. Academic and former soccer player Jules Boykoff has written that the games justify a security architecture to prevent terrorism, but that architecture can double to suppress or intimidate acts of political dissent. The Olympic Charter actually prohibits political activism. As Eagleton puts it, in the face of the infinitely productive forces of meaning, ideology is interested in artificially closing signifiers into a stable, unitary meaning. Quote, constricting the free play of the signifier to a spuriously determinate meaning, which can then be received by the subject, the TV audiences, the tourists that go to spectate, as natural and inevitable. But while communication always involves some provisional semiotic closure, the sort of bodily semiotic enforcement that we see in the Olympic Games is always peeling away at the seams. Siegel says that while TV representation of the games frames and edits and glorifies the action, the Olympics look different in the flesh. These games are like an elaborate recipe that is missing some essential ingredients, he writes, citing wonky translations and the lack of simple navigational markers. By the time the games opened, fewer than 15% of the promotional signs had yet to arrive, prompting an emergency meeting with the supplier. Meanwhile, when interim president Michel Temer announced the opening of the games, he was met by resounding boos, which the organizers tried to drown out by increasing the volume of the music. The physical presence of the Olympic Games constitutes a sign whose meaning is enforced bodily, closed into something inevitable and seemingly innocent. What could be wrong with human achievement and sportsmanship, it asks. There's obviously more to it under the surface, but the thing about the Olympics is that the physical signifier uses its own temporariness as a shield. Someone I know the other day was saying that it's as if everyone stops fighting each other for the Olympics, only to pick up right where they left off as soon as the games end. And when they do end, the Olympic structure is vacated and abandoned. The signifier empties of meaning and absents itself from public currency. The enforcement of unitary meaning stops, but really so does the Olympics as a sign. It becomes inert for the next 4 years. I guess one thing to take away from this is that it's useful to be circumspect about sign-intensive activities, events and celebrations, traditions and pop culture in general. When there is great effort to control, even enforce, a unitary meaning upon a sign or system of signs, pay attention to the margins, where the play of signification is often still at work, bleeding, as it were, through the seams. Thank you for watching. It's been raining and storming really bad while I've been making this video. Hopefully none of that made it into the audio. If you're confused about what I mean with all this semiotics and signs and other stuff, I just finished a series introducing the idea of semiotics as a theory for understanding our mediated reality, so I'll put a link for that in the doobly-doo. And if you enjoyed this video, now would be a great time to subscribe.